Hi, I'm Sophie, one half of Sophie Tucker, and I'm here at Amoeba, and this is what's in my bag.
Larry Bird.
Okay, so I would love to start with this one, which is the first one that caught my eye. This is the Buena Vista Social Club album, and it is the soundtrack to my childhood. I think my parents are the type of people with music who they just decide what they like and then they just listen to it to death. You know, like there was not that much variety. This album, all the time, every Sunday. My dad never got sick of this album. And I remember very distinctly watching the documentary about how the Buena Vista Social Club was created. They were just like musicians in Cuba, or, you know, not making a living making music, that were found basically on the street and then made this incredible album. I moved a lot growing up, and this album was the thing that made me feel like home. Like, even though I was in different houses, like the candlesticks were the same, the furniture was the same, and this album was the same. And not much else was the same. We were always in different countries. Yeah. Feels like Sunday morning.
It's a beautiful Sunday morning album.
It's the best. This is the next one because I'm doing this in order of my life. And this was the most popular album at my high school. Nigeriano clandestino, Boliviano clandestino, mano negra ilegal. Tucker and I always talk about high school and cultural references, and he is often astounded that I just don't know a lot of the cultural references. But I went to high school in a very unique way. I went to a boarding school in Italy. There are 200 students from 100 countries. And so like the things that were popular were not the same as what, you know, was popular in a high school in the US. And this album was just like the cool album. Like everyone really felt cool listening to it. I felt cool listening to it, and I felt very like worldly and very, I don't know. Especially he talks about like marijuana, and I remember everyone being like, that's so cool. Marijuana illegal. But the other thing that's cool about this is that Manu Chao is French, and he lived actually in the same town in Brazil that I lived in. Yeah, in Santa Teresa. And I didn't realize that he didn't speak Spanish as his native tongue. And so that was actually very influential to me, because I was like, oh, there's this person who actually their native tongue is French, but most of the music that they're putting out into the world is Spanish. And so I was like, oh, I could do that. So, you know, a lot of the music that we put out is Portuguese. And I think he was extremely influential, even unconsciously, in feeling like that was even a possibility to do. And then it also turns out he's friends with Bomba Stereo, who are friends of ours. And we were just staying with them, and you know, I was like staying in a room, and they were like, yeah, like Manu Chao was here staying in that room, and I was like, ah! Oh my god. Volando vengo, volando voy, deprisa, deprisa, rumbo perdido. So cool. Okay. This is the next one in order of influence. I fall in love too easily. I fall in love too fast. In college, I started to take vocal lessons, and really vocal lessons for me was like therapy. I would go in and my voice teacher and I would just talk for a long time, and then I would sing Chet Baker songs pretty much exclusively for a long time, especially I Fall in Love Too Easily. Just being like, this is so my life. I fall in love too easily. But all of these, like I sang all of these in my voice lessons. I really like how subtle he sings. I don't have a very loud voice, and so I often found in voice lessons that like my voice didn't match the songs, but they would match these types of songs. Like the softer jazz songs, like I gravitated towards because I could actually sing them and they made sense with my voice. Whereas a lot of the like more belty, louder stuff, I just felt like really, it was like pants that didn't fit. Yeah, so when I found Chet Baker, I just leaned in hard.
You make me smile with my heart.
So that leads me to the next one. So I was singing just very soft jazz in college. And then in the same book, like, it started, like, some Portuguese jazz songs started to appear. A lot of these ones.
Da janela, vê seu corcovado, o redentor, que lindo.
And so I started singing Corcovado, Chega de Saudade.
E aqui não sai de mim, não sai de mim, não sai.
And basically, I was singing in Portuguese, and I was like even more attracted to the songs that were written in Portuguese than the songs that were written in English. And so I put like a poster on my dorm wall that was just like pronunciation in Portuguese so that I could sing these songs, and I was singing them all the time. And that my voice teacher was the one who had the idea. She was like, why don't you just take Portuguese? Like, it's offered at this college. Then you could actually understand what you're saying. And so I took Portuguese and then like fell really even deeper in love with singing these songs.
João Gilberto.
I couldn't find his album Voice e Violão, but that's actually my favorite one of his. But this is, I mean, this is like classic. Best songwriter of all time. Just gonna say that. It's the most complex, I think, too. Because you only have, he has, for the most part, I mean, especially the other album, it's just him and the guitar. The guitar is doing all of the rhythms that a drum would usually do. Like, it's doing the samba rhythms. The chord progressions are extremely complex, and the way that like first goes to chorus, goes to bridge, whatever goes to different parts of the songs is just, it's advanced. It's very impressive. Yeah. And it's sexy. This is yet another Brazilian music album. So after I studied Portuguese, I became infatuated and I lived in Brazil. And then I came back and I studied Brazilian music, and it was actually a course that I could take in college. So we studied this album especially a lot. And basically it was the start of a movement in the 60s. This is a collection of a lot of my favorite Brazilian artists. And they did an album together, and it really started this cultural movement, which was like against the military dictatorship and like the oppressive regime. And it was this like super bright, colorful counterculture movement.
Debaixo das rosas dos jardins, debaixo da lama.
They're so cool. Yeah, so Gilberto Gil, one of the most influential, Caetano Veloso. Who else is on here? Gal Costa.
Heavy hitters.
Heavy hitters. All in one. And then I wanted to make sure that I included an English-speaking artist. So this album in particular was like the turning point for me to decide that I wanted to make music forever. Feist has, I think, the coolest voice. It's like really, really, really powerful and then really, really, really subtle. And her lyricism is next level. This album, Metals, came out my sophomore year in college. And I just remember listening to it all the time and feeling like I could make something. Not like it, but I just think that the best art makes you want to make your own stuff. And I went to see her at the House of Blues in Boston. I'd seen her like 6 different times. And there was this one show in particular, I remember watching her on stage and she's playing the electric guitar and just like looking like she's having the time of her life. And I was like, yeah, I'm gonna do that. I have to do that. Like, I really, really want to do that. That just looks like what I have to do. And she's doing it. And I had no idea how I was going to get there, but she was, yeah, number one inspiration, for sure.
How come you never go there? How come?
so alone.
And then this is for Tucker, because he's not here right now, but he loves Dr. Dre, and I found this amazing shirt. And he's also 6'7", so must wear very large shirt.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We really appreciate you coming down and talking with us today.
Yeah, it was really fun. Thank you. If it's 1-on-1, if it's 2-on-2, I wanna play wet tennis all night with you. We can play wet tennis. We're tenders. We were hot.